Adam RPG. On an alternate version of Earth, in 1986, nuclear war devastated the world. No victor arose from those ashes, but the remnants of humanity clung to life. They began to rebuild as best they could. New cities, new battles, new irradiated mutants. You enter this world in 2005 as a cadet with the mysterious organization, Adam. Adam's goal is to quietly better the lives of the Wastelanders. As a result of this organization hiding in the shadows, they've become mythical. Many people doubt that Adam even exists. After the tutorial, which takes place in an Adam base, you venture out into the world. Then you, a highly trained Adam agent, immediately lose everything to the very first bandits you encounter. This isn't optional. The player can't do anything about it. You lose all of your equipment. After that plot point, it's a standard isometric RPG in many respects. The graphics are fine, the music is good. You wander around in this landscape, exploring it, talking to NPCs, solving quests, fighting things, getting gear, selling excess gear, crafting new stuff, building a base, getting companions, and so on. Its gameplay aspects will be very familiar to anyone used to the genre. I thought that the game got some things right, and some things wrong. Character creation. Out of the gate, I will say that I liked both the variability and fairness of character creation. There are many options to tweak. You can craft a melee warrior, go grenadier with throwing items, or select a gun-based playstyle with one of the several different types of guns if you want to go the weapons route. You can also bypass a ton of combat if you want to go the speechcraft route. You can play more diplomatically rather than just aggressively if you prefer that. Some combat is unavoidable. After all, you can't reason with a horribly mutated animal or a person that's a shadow of who they once were. But talking your way out of trouble is a neat aspect to the game, and that's frequently an available option. The aesthetics aren't as varied, though. You do have preset portraits to choose from, but I didn't really care about that. The aesthetics were good enough for me. Some people may want to mod that, so heads up. And there is an existing portrait mod out there, I just haven't tried it myself. As for the avatar, it'll usually be hidden underneath gear. There are different types of helmets, facial coverings, and body armor. And on the topic of gear, I like that I didn't have to wear high heels, tank tops, or anything stupid on my character. These are harsh living conditions, and the equipment is realistic and reflects that. The realism was nice. Similarly, NPCs didn't harass me in weird, over-the-top ways, which has happened to me in other games when I've played as a female character. Exploration. I like exploring maps in games and discovering new places and hidden items. But in Adam RPG, both exploring areas and the world map can be tedious. When exploring an area, then many containers should be checked for quest-related items and gear. Many of these containers will either be empty or contain useless junk. If you can grab the item that scans things, then that makes searching easier, because containers that aren't empty will glow green. But that still doesn't help avoiding finding junk. And it's not fun to keep finding forks and spoons and bricks and whatever. Plus, holding the scanner is irritating because if combat starts, then one of your two slots will be occupied with the scanner. Removing and adding it to a hand slot repeatedly isn't engaging. The map is large and travel takes a while. Traveling around also leads to random encounters, which can be interesting. Let you gain a dog, let you trade with a caravan, or just flat out lead to a fight with bandits, crazy cultists, or spiders, or whatever. Fights will lead to experience points, and human mobs can be lucrative to farm. I got timed explosives, armor, guns, and other highly useful items from these random encounters. But you can also avoid many random encounters if you'd like to. A high survival skill will let you bypass them, but Speechcraft will also let you choose to bypass fights with human beings via talking your way out of trouble. If you find and acquire the car, it is much easier to get around. Until then, it is possible to hitch rides on motorized caravans, but they're not always going to the city that you want to get to. That's realistic, but it does add to the grind of traveling. That's why having the car definitely makes map travel easier, because you can quickly go to the places you want to go to. But getting the car is a little complicated, it's not obvious where it's at. Plus, there's even a car-related scam that you can fall for and lose gold to, and a broken car that you can't repair. feels a bit like trolley game design. After all, I wanted the car. And while you can travel anywhere on the map, at any level, there is a big issue. You can accidentally skip or ruin quests without meaning to. If the player wanders off, then the player can jump ahead in the plot. For example, I skipped mushroom cult content because I found the next thing in their quest line before finishing the current thing with the pig. This caused the quest giver to disappear and made me unable to finish that quest. Yet, sometimes, the flip side is true, and not exploring enough can ruin quests. An example of this was when I killed a bunch of bandits and then later found out that one was wanted alive for a quest by an NPC that I hadn't spoken to yet. Combat. As you wander around, some combat is inevitable. It's turn-based and not hard to figure out. Knives are melee and close up. Some guns are mid-range, some shoot many bullets while some shoot a few, and how far you can throw is based on your throwing ability. It's simple stuff at its core. Skills and the ability tree boost whichever fighting style you want to hone in on. You also don't have to fight alone. If you've recruited them, then NPC companions will help you fight. But this is where combat gets wonky. On your turn, you can tell companions to move to and hold a certain spot, which enemy they should attack, if the companion should avoid combat, or if they should fight offensively or defensively. Before combat starts, you also have a few more things that you can specify. Out of combat, you can say if you want them to auto-heal, if they should auto-attack the same enemy you do in a fight or not, and if they should fire or not if there's any chance of them hitting their own teammates in combat. Friendly fire is a thing in this game. The problem is that these commands aren't always followed, even when a companion is instructed to never shoot if there's even a slight chance of hitting a teammate. Friendly fire will still happen. They also often ignored my other commands, too. If I wanted them to auto-attack the same enemy that I did, then they often chose another enemy instead. Telling them to avoid combat also sometimes went really badly, and they'd walk into the bad guys instead of away from them. This led to them blocking clear shots and dying if they had low HP and needed to retreat. At other points, if told to fight, then they'd pace weirdly instead and waste their turns. Even healing could go badly. If they got hit hard, then they'd often go for the weakest healing item on them. They'd do this even if severely injured in just a hit or two. This meant that they'd quickly die because they were losing HP faster than they were regaining it. I quickly learned that I had to confiscate all of their weak healing pills and let them only have the strong stuff. Random NPCs fighting alongside your team are even stupider. It'll happen sometimes where they'll join you. For example, here, I tried to heal a guard. He got angry that I tried to use the stimulant item to heal him. The stimulant item is basically this game's heal wounds potion. The guard said that he hated drugs and to get them away. Then he used the same drug on himself to heal. I wasted a turn on that one. Other than the wonkiness, combat itself wasn't too difficult. I replayed the game on expert mode to review it since I'd played it before, but a long time ago, and I remembered it as being easy to beat. My playstyle was gun-based. I just bought bullets of every type whenever I found them on a merchant. I stockpiled bullets because I knew that they were handy, yet scarce. This meant that even if I currently lacked the gun type for an ammunition type, then ammo might still become useful later on. And that strategy worked well. Guns made combat pretty easy. Farming bandits, slavers, and cultists, and then selling their unwanted gear also helped. It made money and increased the bullet stockpiles. The biggest challenge was just keeping my companions from acting like idiots, and I couldn't. This meant that even though fights were easy and shouldn't have posed problems, they still sometimes went badly. I made sure that I quicksaved before combat. Crafting. The crafting system is pretty simple. Some items will help boost your crafting ability, the game will tell you what your chance of a successful craft is, and you'll lose materials if you fail. If you succeed, then you get both the item and a small amount of experience points. As for what you can make, you can find recipes for sale or scattered around the world map, but there's no artificial block in front of the crafting. You don't have to find the recipe in-game to make something. You can experiment to try to figure out what recipes exist, or if you really want, you could just cheat by looking the recipes up online. The list of what can be made is rather small, though. The crafting system is helpful, but it's not really necessary. I didn't mess with it much because it just didn't benefit me that much. Instead, I either bought what I needed, found it while exploring, or got it from combat, which was easy. Base building. You get to build your own little neighborhood out in the wasteland, and you can either accept or reject some people who want to live there. However, this aspect felt tacked on to me, because base building didn't influence the game too much. NPCs are not highly interactive in MMORPG, so the people who moved in didn't matter to me. They also weren't helpful to my PC because they could make things, but I didn't really need anything that they made. For example, cows could give milk, but I didn't even bother collecting any since I rarely needed any milk. I could also easily buy it from a merchant if I wanted to. And another guy makes decent armor out of bug parts, but it's not better than other armor that can be purchased from merchants. The companions. I didn't find the companions to be very interesting. Two are easy to recruit, Fidel and Hexagon. Fidel is part of the main plot line because he's your Adam contact. He's a generic good guy who doesn't get much character development beyond that. He's lawful good, basically. He exclaims things in Spanish and occasionally tells you to do the right thing. As for Hexagon, he's a senile author who is, well, chaotic evil, really. He rambles, has violent tendencies, and tends to be nice to those who flatter him. You can easily get him at your future base site, but the guy is unstable and joining you seems like nothing but intended comic relief. He rambles constantly during the plot and even when engaging with random NPCs, and the NPCs will respond to him too, but he's clearly nuts and fine with chaos. He even eggs you on to launch a nuke, if you find it in the game. I don't think he knows or cares where the nuke goes either, because you can launch it at California in the USA, Kulai in Malaysia, or into the UK. His attitude is just to get back at humanity for using bombs by using more bombs. And this is the same guy who saved a bunch of bunnies and calls you his child. Giving him a gun and having him by your side seems like a really stupid decision if you're role-playing in Adam RPG. An unstable old man with a gun who wants to nuke people and cause chaos, not exactly a good partner for somebody trying to be clandestine. Some NPCs even ask why the heck he's with you, but from a metagaming standpoint, he does decent damage and can carry a lot. The other companions are a dog who can be found and rescued, Alexander, who can be recruited at your base if you pass the proper checks to recruit him, and a slave woman, Gulchitai, who can't fight, but can act like a pack mule in the background. It's also possible to get a woman called Galena, but you have to do evil stuff to get her. If you go that route, then Fidel and Hexagon will leave the squad, which is pretty bizarre in Hexagon's case, given that he was enthusiastic about nuking strangers and further darkening the entire Earth. But, well, that's chaotic alignment for you. Anyway, I had Fidel, Hexagon the dog, and for a little while, Gulchitai. Fidel was bland, Hexagon was insane in an unfun, rambling way. The dog was okay, but also bland, there wasn't much interaction there, and Gulchitai was sad and quiet. None of them were endearing or fun to have around. They also aren't voiced. The dog barks during combat and whimpers if it gets hurt, but that's as audible as the companions get. The story. The story is difficult to explain without giving too much away. Essentially, the military have been doing experiments, and some of these are loose now. Meanwhile, there's a secret evil cartel, a mysterious mushroom cult, two cities trying to thrive in the wasteland, bandits galore, slavers galore, a hidden major threat to the world, ancient entities lurking in the background, and then there's you, walking around with your companions and causing havoc, peace, or something in between. I found some of the plot and subplots to be interesting. The mushroom cult was my favorite twist because there was some interesting lore behind it and a neat general concept of what they were hoping to achieve and why they wanted to. There wasn't a ton, but there was enough to keep it interesting. Yet, there was one big problem that I had with Adam RPG's story, which was that it was consistently dark and forced those dark choices onto the player. Encountering dark subjects is understandable. The opening intro even notes that it's a world where morality has vanished. There are horrible encounters, ranging from slavery to dogfights to an incestuous family that abuses their kids to people who eat mothers and their unborn babies. The whole idea is that society's morals broke down and there's a lot of bad things that go on. And okay, so the society lacks morals, got it. Yet, why does the player have to lack morals too? Because there's often not an option to make any of these situations better, even when the player could reasonably do a lot of good. Sometimes you can act, and sometimes the option just isn't there. That lack of intervention also makes little sense, considering that Fidel, the player's do-gooder sidekick, ought to at least be the type to do something about the horrors he also is there to witness. As a result, the horror seems forced, overdramatic, and Fidel seems like a weak NPC, a doll who only has plot-convenient moral reactions at random. And the fact that sometimes you can do things, and sometimes you can't, also makes the times you can feel weird because, well, why then? Why not this other time? For example, here, I fought a bunch of slavers. A woman was with them, and she was stripped down to her underwear. When spoken to, she only said a few generic lines. She didn't even have a name and was labeled as would-be slave by the game when she's looked at by the player. I thought that I could at least lead her back to a town, or even to my own base if she had nowhere to go home to. Instead, the player gets to leave her to die, in her underwear, in the middle of a desert wasteland filled with bandits, slavers, and monsters. I guess I saved her? Yay? The same thing goes for the three abused children that you can find. Only one of those kids doesn't seem to be twisted and insane from her abuse, but she's clearly deeply traumatized. You could take her with you, but you don't. You can't. Instead, all you can do is leave her in the terrible bunker with her other siblings and their mother, who encouraged her sexual abuse. You have houses in the sunshine, but you leave her in darkness. There's also a dogfighting ring in the city of Paragon, but you can't end it without causing the entire city to aggro you, including the dogs. And while the dogs seem to be rare commodities in the wasteland, after all, they're not everywhere, you also can't buy them up even if you have massive amounts of cash on you. You can't even offer to buy a single dog to save it. Yet, you can enter or sell off your own dog, like he means nothing to you. Those options are there. The option to make the situation at all better by trying to hoard dogs? Nope. There's also no other way to stop it. I guess you could imagine at the end that maybe if you make the city a better place it stops, but there's no evidence for that. These constant options to choose evil, with rare options to ever choose anything good, felt ridiculously over the top to me. There just wasn't any balance to the choices offered to the player. I can understand that a post-apocalyptic landscape is dark and NPCs would be evil, but the choices available to the player felt narrow. It just felt as if the game kept asking me if I wanted to be evil too, and when I said no, it just seemed like I got a narrative shrug and another attempt later on. The ending wasn't satisfying for me either. At the end of the game, an epilogue rolls to say how various things turned out as the result of the player's actions. But I didn't care. The living, city-dwelling NPCs were all dull at best, or cheering on dying dogs to kill each other at worst. I had no interest in these people and no concern for their cities. As for my companions, they felt like strangers who followed me around, and their going their separate ways after the game concluded seemed to confirm that. After all, I had a base, yet neither I nor they stuck around. And that'll happen whether or not you take the time to perfect the base. You guys will drift apart regardless. There's no emotional attachment between your PC and the NPCs. The PC always seems to feel as meh about their companions as I did, really. So, all in all, I just didn't like the game. It had some good points, but they were overwhelmed by the flaws. Playing a game in which I was forced to ignore the horrors around my character, even when my character could reasonably help out those around her, wasn't engaging. It also made the points where I could suddenly solve a problem feel weird in contrast. Meanwhile, exploring the world was often tedious. Combat was due to the companions' poor AI, and the companions themselves didn't hold my interest. How they varied in their responses to suit the plot also felt hollow. A few story threads kept me playing until the end of the game, mainly the mushroom cult, but that was all they did, they just kept me playing. I felt curious, but I didn't feel extremely invested into the game's world as a whole, and while the answers I got about the mushroom cult were decent, they weren't enough to make me feel like the game itself was worth recommending as a whole. As a result of all of that taken together, I think it's an okay RPG, but just an okay one. And by the way, it's worth underlining that due to its content, it's definitely not something for kids to play. Adult content is normal in mature games, but this one does have a lot of it. I didn't even cover all of the dark stuff, and there's also raunchy stuff too, like a prostitute trying to get the player to go on a quest to make the kinkiest porno ever. The game's definitely meant for a mature audience.